Good evening all, and welcome to today's webinar on seasonal strategies. I'll start now by perhaps introducing Ian McFarlane, who's our Senior Livestock Consultant with Rural Solutions with PIRSA and Coordinator of Sheep Connect.
Yeah, welcome to the webinar tonight. Just a quick rundown on what Sheep Connect is. It's an extension project providing opportunities and activities for producers to get involved in, a focus on making positive change to on-farm production and management practices. That's across the pastoral area and the agricultural areas. So Sheep Connect wouldn't exist without support from our major sponsors, and that's Australian Wool Innovation, Primary Industries and Regions, and the SA Sheep Industry Fund. As Pip said, I'm the project manager, and Jodie Rose is our pastoral coordinator. Just a quick waiver for information tonight, should be of value, but we've just got to put that one up. So tonight's webinar is about seasonal strategies. So over the past week or so, we've had some good rains across the state. However, that will impact individuals differently, depending how much you got, where you were, what your current situation was. So tonight we'll be talking about grazing failed crops, feeding strategies, and spring cover crop options. So we'll start with Michael Wurst, and Michael will be talking on grazing failed crops. Michael's a consultant with Primary Industries based at Jamestown.
Thanks, Ian. So I've been given the job of talking about failed crops, and it's one of those things that seems to come up when we have one of these dry seasons. And certainly in the last month or so, there's been quite a bit of interest in whether we should be looking at grazing failed crops or not. And Grain and Graze has certainly been doing some work on grazing crops over the last 5 to 10 years, but they've mainly been focusing on grazing crops early and then letting them go for grain. But they also have done a little bit of work on grazing what they call sacrificial crops rather than, I suppose, the failed crops. Looking at whether we should be grazing crops or not, I think really it should be looked at a last resort, and we should be looking at focusing on confinement feeding wherever possible. And now I know some parts of the state have had a little bit of rain, and hopefully if we get some favourable, follow-up rains, we might get a little bit of pasture growth. So that might be beneficial. But certainly other parts of the state haven't had as much rain, and we're still going to need a lot of rain to get significant pasture growth. So I suppose the issue is for some of these guys that are really short on feed, grazing crops is certainly an option. So if you have a planning to graze crops or have already even started, I think there's a couple of things to bear in mind. One is to actually select the most appropriate paddock to graze, and that's taking into account soil type, the biomass of the crop. So is it going to be worthwhile grazing? How much grazing value are you actually going to get out of it? And also the size of the paddock, because if you've got large paddocks, it's going to be really hard to graze them sort of evenly and get good value out of it. The other thing I think is to look at is the erosion risk of the paddock, and I think in quite highly erosion prone paddocks, we really probably, maybe might be best to actually leave them to go to grain, and then hopefully if we get some follow-up rains, we might be able to harvest them, or the other option is to actually graze them over summer as a standing crop. However, if you think that, we are going to go ahead and graze the crop, I think we need to make the decision, early, whether you're going to graze it or not. And I suppose when you're doing the sums, use realistic rainfall expectations, yields, and also, I suppose, prices. So who knows, I suppose, what prices are going to be later on in the year. Grain prices just seem to be creeping up, which is pretty hard for those guys that aren't going to have much of a harvest. But the other thing I suppose we need to look at is how much seed we might need. And so we've got to make sure that we're going to be able to harvest enough seed for next year's seed supplies, and also to have grain on hand to feed the sheep as well. Also, I think you need to look at is the food value of the crop to the livestock, both from a quantity and a quality point of view. And to help with work out this the economics of doing this, New South Wales DPI have put together a calculator a few years ago, and there's the link to that calculator. But if you haven't got time to write it down, you can just Google salvage crops, and that seems to come up pretty quickly. So if you do decide that grazing crops is the way to go, I think it's going to be essential that any bare areas get fenced off, because that's where the stock are going to camp, and they're just going to bear them out more and stir the soil up and cause further erosion. So you can either do it, you know, using electric fences, and everyone groans, I think, when we talk about that. But the other thing that a few farmers did last year was just rolled out some cyclone, used a few star droppers, and you know, all you need to do is a bit of a barrier just to keep the majority of the stock off those bare areas. You don't need to keep every last one off. So if you get through, I don't think that's going to be a drama. The other thing is if you've got reasonably large paddocks, it's really beneficial to actually split those paddocks so you can get high stocking rates or high stock densities, and really would like to aim for 20 DSE per hectare or even more. And so obviously, if you're doing that, then you'll need to have portable watering points, which does create another complication. But if you use a polytrough, which is easy to transport, and you know, maybe a trailer with a tank or even some shuttles would be probably enough, because at this time of the year, the stock probably aren't drinking a lot of water, because they'll be able to get quite a bit of water from the crop. The reason we want, reason that we see the benefit from splitting paddocks up is the fact that they will be having less distance to walk, and they use up a lot of energy walking, and also in walking they trample the crop and also increase the wastage. And then if you're putting high stocking numbers on, you're only grazing it for a short time, and so this avoids the stock actually camping and bearing areas out. The other thing that'll be essential to do is a rough feed budget. So really need a good estimate of how much feed is available in the crop, so the only way to do that is really to take some dry matter cuts, and a lot of the crops are going to be fairly uneven. You have, you know, quite good growth in some areas and relatively poor growth in other areas, so you're going to have to do cuts in a number of different areas. But rather than doing drying it, you can probably use a guesstimate of say 25 to 30% dry matter, because I'd say at this time of the year, most crops would be around about that. The other assumption that we can use is that and the rule of thumb that we tend to use is that one DSE will eat approximately 1 kilogram of green feed per day. However, you know, if you've got a ton of green feed there, you can't plan to eat that whole ton. You probably have to budget maybe on eating half of it. So that will then leave a bit of ground cover, and you also need to allow for a bit of wastage. And also, if you've got some green leaf there, the plants will recover and you'll get a bit more growth, which will improve your ground cover, before summer. So I think the really important thing to keep in mind is do not overgraze, especially when you've got high stock densities on there. If you leave the stock on there for one extra day, the crop can go from having quite good cover to being bare very quickly. So you really have to monitor and keep on top of it. Now this table here just shows the amount of food intake of different types of stock. So that sort of gives an indication of the densities that you can put on of various animals. So lambs are eating about, say, 1.5 kilograms per day, whereas a lactating ewe is closer to 2. The other thing I think to take into account when grazing crops is the withholding period of any chemicals that might have been applied. Now, this is a legal requirement to ensure, you know, maximum residue limits or the export grazing intervals are not exceeded. And it can be surprising how long some of these withholding periods are for some chemicals. You know, some of them can be up to, you know, 3 months. So it really pays to check what each product is before you put the stock in. The final thing I think to take into account is stock health. When you're putting stock onto a green crop, and especially if they've been in a feedlot or eating dry food, you know, their digestive system isn't used to it. So it pays to actually feed them hay so that they're full before you actually put them onto the crop. Otherwise they'll go in hungry and you can end up with issues. And the other thing is, once you've got them on the crop, it pays to actually provide a little bit of supplementary feed, you know, maybe some hay or some straw, just to reduce any metabolic disease problems. Now, there is a pretty low risk of getting nitrate toxicity, but it still probably pays to monitor the levels. I'd say, you know, it really is only an issue where you've put on high rates of nitrogen on the crops, and most farmers probably haven't done that this year. So hopefully that's not such an issue. The other thing is to check to make sure they've been vaccinated for pulpy kidney. It's also for lactating stock, sometimes they can run into calcium deficiency. So lime application or lime supplement can be quite beneficial. So that's been very quick run through on a couple of the issues to cover, but I'll now sort of hand over to questions.
So Michael, there's one question or comment around, is there a benefit in having a low stocking rate, just slightly grazing the crop so the crop can still keep growing away from the sheep?
Yeah, I suppose that is a good point. That will, I can see what they're trying to get at there. The issue will be is that because they're walking around, they'll probably do a trample a fair bit, and also they'll tend to camp in some areas. So you might get some camping. But if you've got a low stocking rate, maybe that won't be such an issue.
Yeah, I think the question is also relating to, you know, maintaining some ground cover as well.
Good point. Yeah, so certainly by doing that, so that's probably what we call just a light graze. That would probably certainly give more ground cover. But the thing is that the sheep will probably still eat the heads or, you know, in the boot, so you probably won't get much grain out of it. But certainly you might get more ground cover.
So Deb is a technical ruminant person working with Alltech Leonets based in the Clare Valley. So Deb will be talking about feeding strategies.
Great, thanks for that, Ian. Yeah, I'm just going to run through some of the strategies, I guess, we're using to get through a tough season like this. So I'm just going to cover off initially just which stock to feed if you are running low on feed, some weaning management, managing weaners as far as feed types, and also just an example of a weaner ration and costs. So obviously you guys are all well aware of the seasonal conditions this year, but you know, we're looking at very serious rain deficiencies for a lot of areas. You know, we're probably severe to low in South Australia, but you know, the issue is, I guess, the drought through other areas has taken a lot of the feed resources and pushed up the cost of feed types. So it's becoming tricky now to make recommendations. It's becoming what feed we can access rather than what we should be accessing. So as far as which stock to feed, obviously everyone's farm is different and what feed they have stored or can purchase in. But we're looking at, I guess, if you do need to cull stock, any non-productive stock are probably the best ones to cull. So we're looking at if you haven't lambed yet, so most guys probably have lamb, but if you haven't, then preg testing and culling any empty ewes. We're looking at, I guess, feeding the mouths that are going to produce the biggest income for you. Also twins and singles, it is a good year if they are split to allocate feed resources separately. Even with lactating stock, if you've got a twin mob different to a singles mob, it enables you just to allocate a bit more feed to those to get a better result. Also lamb marking, just wet and drying, same thing, any of those dry ewes we're sort of encouraging people to get rid of. You know, other years you might give them another chance, but it's just about reducing the numbers that you need to allocate feed to. I'll touch on shortly just some factors of early weaning. So that's something we're probably pushing, is just weaning a little bit earlier if you can see your weaners starting to go backwards. You know, a lot of people are selling off the older line of ewes that they might have got one more lamb off. But I guess we're looking at keeping your core breeding unit, keeping those younger ewes, and in some ways growing stock out if you don't have feed can become uneconomical versus keeping your core breeding stock so that you can still breed a lamb for next year. So we're sort of looking, I guess, next season and the season on after that. So when we talk about weaning earlier, what we look at here is this line here. So it's a percent of energy that lamb's getting from milk and the percent they're getting from pasture, or in this year, a lot of areas, it's the percent they're getting from supplementary feed. So when we talk about weaning a bit earlier, we look at that between 8 and 12 weeks, and it depends a lot on size of the weaner. But we look at that point, you get down to sort of only 30% of the energy coming from milk. So it's then that you can take the ewe away from the lamb and raise the lamb separately. So what we look at with that is it can become a lot more economical to feed a lamb direct than feed it via the ewe once you get to that sort of 10 weeks of age onwards. So when feed's tight, it can be an effective way to do things. So looking at weight, lambs down to 15 kilos is a bit of a guide. I'll go through some figures on this a bit later, but we don't want too many lighter lambs. It just increases your risk of fatality of those young lambs. So what we look at, some people are taking, you know, the top group of weaner lambs off and then coming back in a couple of weeks and taking the bottoms. We do want to stick to that sort of 15 kilo plus if we can. Then we'll look a bit later at some rations and appropriate supplementation. And then we also look at overweaning, just reducing stress. So doing everything we can to give that weaner the best chance of getting up and going and continuing to grow into a decent lamb. So another tool that you can use if you aren't keen to wean your lambs off, or you do have a group of smaller lambs, is this creep weaning type setup. So we have a lot of producers do this in a good season, but it works very effectively in a poor season when feed's expensive. So what we do is basically leave the panels open, let the ewe train the lamb to the feeder. So it's really effective if the ewes have gone to feeders in the past. The lamb will be trained on. We then close up the gap and just the lamb can go in and access the feed. So we're looking at, you know, if barley is probably creeping its way to 350 a tonne at the moment, how can we get the best growth rate over the whole enterprise and make the biggest dollars back of that sort of expensive feed? So when you look at weaning, it's a very stressful time for a lamb. So we look at ways to reduce the stress. So what you see is you get immune suppression, you get decreased appetite, decreased nutrient absorption, increased urination and defecation, so increased dehydration. So it becomes a vicious cycle. So you all would have seen it, that tail of weaners, the smaller ones that you maybe shouldn't have taken off, and you just watch them sulking in the corner and gradually going downhill until, you know, a percentage of them often won't survive. So we basically look at ways to avoid this, using nutrition and also using the ewe to introduce the young lamb to feed prior to weaning. So we look at, and this is something we heavily recommend even in good seasons, is this rumen development that you can encourage at 6 weeks of age. So if you look at this image on the left here, this is a rumen wall with an animal that's just been exposed to milk. So as you can see, that has quite a smooth rumen wall, lowish sort of surface area. You see this middle rumen, so that's ideal rumen of what we're hoping to achieve with your young weaner lamb. So that lamb's been exposed to milk and grain prior to 6 weeks of age, and what you get is these raised papillae or these finger-like sort of projections that come off of the rumen wall. What that actually does is increases the surface area of that rumen wall, and it increases the feed efficiency of that animal. So doing this early and overweaning, there are a lot of feedlots now that are starting to pay more for lambs that have been exposed to grain early, because they're starting to recognise the ability for that lamb to go on to grain later in life and also do better on grain later in life. So it's an important thing to look at in a good and a bad season. And you can see there with the milk and hay, slightly raised, but nothing like the grain introduction. So in a season that is tough like this, and we are doing a lot of supplementary feeding, we're looking at using the ewe to introduce the lamb, weaner lamb, to whichever feed they're going to go on to. So whether it's full feed pellets, grain, hay, once the lamb's used to that, you can then go through the weaning process. So when I talked prior about the 15 kilo weaning weight, the reason we look at getting the weaner to a decent weight prior to weaning is just this mortality rate. So they've shown that a 14 kilo weaner has a 34% lower mortality risk than a 12 kilo weaner. A 20 kilo weaner has a 22% lower mortality risk than an 18 kilo weaner. So you all would have seen those smaller animals that you take off, they maybe shouldn't have been taken off the ewe, and they're the ones that end up being that percentage that don't make it. So we need to look at the ewe nutrition as well prior to doing a weaning, just to try and get that weaner to the heaviest possible weight we can so that they do survive. And I guess when we look at the cost of supplementary feeding this year, I guess we're focusing on the association between growth rate, body weight and mortality risk. It means that supplementary feeding around weaning can be quite a cost-effective option, even with the prices of grain. So just wanting to touch on a few other things that are fairly crucial with weaners. So vaccination. So we always recommend a 3-in-1 or 6-in-1, doing your first shot at marking and then doing your second shot at weaning, just to make sure they're covered for those clostridial diseases. So as I said, during that weaning cycle, it's when the lamb is probably the most stressed. So making sure they're up to date with vaccinations, and also Michael's already mentioned the pulpy kidney. Strongly recommend that in a year like this. You know, with the rains we've had, hopefully they'll be going on to green feed at some point, but also heavy amounts of supplementary feeding. You need to cover them for pulpy anytime they have a change of feed. So those vaccinations only cover you for 3 months, so it's something to keep in mind if they go on to green feed later on. Managing worms also, we're just seeing this year with just quite short green feed, worm burdens can be quite high in weaners. So good to do a fecal egg count or do your normal drenching protocol. Also monitoring weight. So I strongly encourage people to grab, could be just 50 weaners out of the mob, but just have some idea of what the weaning weight was. You know, you can write a number on their back. It doesn't have to be electronic tags or visual even. Weigh them. And just check that you're getting, we want minimum of 30 grams per head per day. Ideally, you'd be closer to the 150 to 200 grams per head per day, but we do need to make sure they're still growing. Also, Michael's touched on this also, but just managing grain feeders that comes through with roughage. So, you know, after the rains we've had, these animals are going to be on a lot of supplementary feeding, a lot of hay and grains. And then putting them onto a lush green paddock, it's crucial to still provide small amounts of roughage, small amounts of grain, even if there's not enough bulk in that feed. So I'll go through an example ration for you guys. But what we're looking at here, I haven't had time sort of in this session to go through confinement feeding, but if you look over on the right hand side here, we just have the recommendations for a weaner. So we're looking at less than 20 or probably 20 to 25 kilo, most of you guys would be weaning at. So we'll base rations on this energy figure. So this animal confinement fed, looking at the less than 20 kilo, that needs 3 to 4 megajoules of energy per head per day to grow. When it's grazing, it needs almost 1 megajoule more of energy. So when we're looking at the cost of supplementary feeding and you know, taking into account some of the ground cover issues and the short green feed we do have in paddocks, it can become more economical to lock the animal up in confinement, and you can get weaners still to grow with appropriate supplementation in a confinement lot. So that's probably an option worth considering. So I'll just touch briefly on some feed types. So when we do nutritional assistance for producers, what we're looking at basically is these four main points. So I don't want to confuse you with too much nutritional information, but what we're looking at mostly is just the dry matter percent of that feed. So I guess this year we're seeing a lot of byproducts being fed to sheep. So I'm just wanting to point out, I guess, when you're looking at value of the feed, when you look at things like your grains, they're generally around that 88 to 90% dry matter. So that means that's the percentage of that feed that contains nutritional value to your animal. When you look at things like citrus pulp, there's quite a lot of that being fed at the moment. So, you know, it can be a good feed, but only 14.3% of that is dry matter. So when you're looking at costs of feed, and especially if you're freighting any feed in, it's worth just looking at the percent dry matter that's going to contain something of value to the stock. Also, just looking at the bottom between silage and hay, there's also a big difference there. We then look at the energy figure. So as I said with the weaner, it's the energy figure we're looking at, which helps them to grow. They also need a minimum amount of protein in their ration. So we still take into account the protein also, and then also the fibre of that. So all the stock in a ration need some form of fibre, especially those really young stock that are quite stressed out. So we look at the NDF figure, or the neutral detergent fibre figure of that feed. So yeah, we can assist you with that if you're not sure on that sort of thing. But another DPI New South Wales calculator. So this is a feed cost calculator, which is just really simple. The link's at the bottom if anyone wants to write it down. But if you're comparing feed types that you've got access to at varying dollars per tonne, for these weaners, I'd just be looking at the energy cost of that feed. So you can see there we've got the clover hay, oaten hay, barley and lupins. So we'll look over the other side and we just look at the cost in cents per megajoule. So you can see there that your barley, even at 320, 2.74 cents per megajoule of energy. So it can still be relatively cost effective way to feed. Your lupins, obviously higher protein, are quite a lot more expensive per unit of energy, but for protein they're quite a lot cheaper. So that's something we can assist you with, selecting which types of feed is the best value, or you can go on that calculator and just have a look at yourself depending on what you can purchase in. So just wanting to mention, I guess, quality. So we've probably seen a lot of average sort of fodder and grain being fed out this year, and it's just because supply is becoming so tight. So especially with your weaner lambs that are quite low body weight, so if you're looking at a 20 kilo lamb, if you do have a mold or mycotoxin issue in feed you're buying, they will be a lot more susceptible to it at a lower weight animal. So it's worth just looking at what you're buying. You know, if you've got lower quality grain, molds, mycotoxin, things like that, it's probably better to feed to animals that aren't in reproductive phases or not weaners or quite stressed sort of young animals. Some of them, you know, not worth feeding at all, but some of them, some ruminants can cope with certain burdens of sort of mycotoxins. So just finishing on your weaner feed example. So just showing you a 20 kilo weaner. So, you know, I think most people sort of weaning 15 to 20 kilos this year just because they haven't come on as well as they normally do with the lack of feed. So that animal requires about 700 grams of dry matter in feed a day is their average sort of intake. From that chart I showed you guys before, so about 4 megajoules of energy and 14% protein that weaner needs to grow. So just showing you an example, so 350 grams of barley, 200 grams of peas and 250 grams of hay would meet those requirements. So that will hit 5 megajoules of energy and 14.5% protein, which will allow that animal to grow. And with current prices, that's going to cost about 16 cents per head per day. So I guess just encouraging you guys to do some feed budgets, work out what they're going to eat, work out what it's going to cost, and then know, with your stock agent, just working out the value of the stock now at 20 kilos, the value at 35 kilos, and the value at 50 kilos, and you know, make some decisions on farm about how you can feed and what you have available. So just covering off, you know, hopefully I've just prompted you guys to have a think about which stock you are going to feed. So, you know, we're doing a lot of work sort of through New South Wales with clients also, and it's, you know, becoming tricky. You know, they're unable to buy feed in now. Some of the stock are sort of too far gone to remove off the property. So it's just looking at, you know, next season, what's the most valuable animals to you guys? You know, can you get good money for a 30 kilo lamb? You know, maybe do a budget, feed them up and get rid of them if you don't think you've got the ability to carry them through. Also, just looking at how you're going to manage your weaners. So, you know, it's a year where we don't want to waste the wrong types of feed. We don't want to put out excess hay. So, you know, doing a maybe full ration, chopping the hay and giving them everything they need to grow as efficiently as possible. And then what feed rations and how much of each ingredient do you need to supplement with?
Okay, thanks, Deb. Would you like to answer that question about how much lime for ewes?
Yeah, I probably can't actually say exactly in grams because we actually sell sort of full products that contain the calcium for lactating stock already. But, you know, going on the guide that we work on an animal eating sort of 25 grams of those supplements per head per day, and they're about 18% calcium. So doing sort of a quick calculation, that'd be what, 12 grams? No, less than that, sorry.
I guess my normal recommendation would be around 1.5%, 1 to 1.5%.
Yeah, okay.
Lime. So,
yeah, righto.
Yeah, so that.
Yeah, well, in that we'd be providing 5 grams per head per day for sort of a normal 50 kilo ewe, so that's 1% anyway, isn't it?
Yep. Yeah. All right, so another question around, is it a myth that if a ewe is losing condition during pregnancy, that the lamb will have less wool follicles and a progeny will also have less wool follicles?
Oh, I probably can't answer that, sorry. I could probably find out, though, and get back to someone if you want to, like, send me an email with that question on it.
So I'd like to now pass over to Brett Masters. Brett's a sustainable ag consultant from Primary Industries, and he's based in Port Lincoln and has expertise in soil survey and interpretation, plant nutrition, managing soil, subsoil constraints and crop and pasture product. So hand it over to you, Brett.
Thanks, Ian. No, I'm just going to talk briefly about some of the options for sowing crops for surface cover. Firstly, and hopefully if we get some spring rainfall, hopefully they're an option for feed as well. So I guess firstly, what happens if we don't get any rain and dry conditions continue? And obviously, Michael and Deb have covered some of that containment feeding and grazing sacrificial crops already. So basically, yeah, we need to keep stock and vehicles off the soils which are inherently prone to erosion through either supplementary feeding stock in containment areas or fencing off those vulnerable areas of the paddocks. And also, you know, Michael's talked a little bit about grazing sacrificial crops. But what if we do get some rain? Can we sow something to provide surface cover? And I'm just going to run through some of the considerations that come into play there. So basically, first is how much rainfall do we need for you to be able to sow some crop to germinate and to get it to establish properly? So, and it probably depends on whether you're looking at sowing a winter cereal, which you might be able to sow on 20 to 25 mils towards the end of August. Whereas if you were sowing a summer forage crop, you might be looking at needing a 30 to 40 mil rainfall event with some stored subsoil moisture as well to get that to establish. The next thing to consider is if you do sow something, what's the risk of the strong winds that we've been having continuing to impact the establishment of crops for your area? So how long or at what point does that wind risk reduce to give you a better chance of actually getting good establishment? And then the next thing is basically, are you sowing that crop just to establish some surface cover? Or are you looking to grow feed? And that's going to depend very much on the predicted spring and summer rainfall outlook. Obviously, in some parts of the states, that's looking at being better than other parts at the moment. So I guess the main point there is basically make plans if you're looking at sowing something, make plans and then wait to see how the season pans out. So just looking at the difference between whether you're deciding to sow a winter cereal or a summer forage crop, some of the things that you might want to consider. Firstly, it's the timing of the rainfall is going to influence the best crop type that you might sow. Obviously, the soil moisture levels as well for getting something like a summer forage crop establishing for feed as opposed to just sowing a cereal for cover. And then availability and cost of seed comes into it. If you've got some spare cereal lying around that could potentially be sown in to provide some of that cover, it may be cheaper than sowing a summer forage crop. But if you have to buy in cereal to sow for cover at $300 plus a ton, that's where it might become more cost effective to sow a summer forage crop. And then the soil temperatures required for crop germination are probably a key factor. That ties in with the timing of rainfall. So I've just got a few brief slides on sort of rainfall timing, what you might sow, and relating it back to soil temperatures. The other thing to consider is plantback periods with your residual herbicides, particularly group B's and your triazines. Some of the summer forage crops have some triazine tolerance, but are obviously fairly susceptible to your group B's and your IMIs and your clear fields there. So firstly, rainfall timing. If we got a rain in August, September, that 20 to 25 mil rainfall event, soil temperatures are still fairly cool. Probably the best option in that is going to be a winter cereal because it has a low soil germination temperature requirement. So pros for sowing winter cereal at that time is that the seed on hand might be cheaper than purchasing seed, and you can get some pretty quick surface cover on that. However, probably one of the cons with sowing a winter cereal, unless it's got a low, you know, unless it's a true winter wheat with a cold vernalisation period, is that it might not provide very much feed value if those warm spring conditions cause it to run up to head quickly. So if we don't get that that August-September rainfall, but we do get a good rainfall in late September, early October, obviously we've got warmer soil temperatures. One of the summer forage options is one of the millets, a Japanese or French white type, which has a lower germination temperature requirement than forage sorghum. So those millets, you can sow them when the soil temperature's in the range 12 to 14 degrees. And remember, when we're testing soil temperature, you're sort of looking at a rising temperature over a period of about a week when you're going out and testing at the same time each day, which is sort of 9 a.m. is the recommended standard for that. So, and just using a meat thermometer or something like that that's got a low temperature, covers those lower temperatures around the 10 to 12 degrees. So basically, yeah, the millet can be sown at lower temperature at 12 to 14 degrees. Millet doesn't have the prussic acid poisoning risk that the sorghums can have if they're not grazed effectively. So that's a positive for sowing millet. And also it's very rapid to establish to get some quick cover there. So, and if you get good soil moisture conditions over that spring and summer period, it can actually be quite a high quality feed. So some of the cons are because it's such a small seed, it requires relatively shallow sowing. You need to sow it at about 20 to 25 millimetres. So if you've got those dry topsoils, it can result in patchy emergence. And it can run straight to head if it's drought stressed and if the grazing's not carefully managed. So the other problem with a lot of the summer forage crops is that there are few herbicide options for taking those weeds out. So it won't tolerate group B's, and millet is generally intolerant of triazine residues, although some of the French white types can tolerate some cimazine residues there. So just finally, if we get that rainfall in mid to late October, you've got warmer temperatures. That's probably where your forage sorghums come into being an option. So they've got a soil germination temperature requirement of 16 to 18 degrees, but they have good drought tolerance when they're established. So, and again, some varieties will tolerate triazine residues. Because they're a larger seed, they can be sown deeper into moisture. So if you've got dry topsoils, but you've got some moisture down at that 50 to 75 mil depth, then you can actually sow deep at that seed deeper into the moisture at depth. So obviously the cons is that higher soil temperature required for germination, and sorghums can have a risk of prussic acid toxicity when the plants are young or when they're moisture stressed. So you've got to be you've got to carefully manage the grazing on those on sorghum where you don't have that issue if you're grazing a millet. So just in summary, if dry conditions continue, minimise the risk of erosion by fencing off vulnerable areas or feeding the stock in containment areas. If spring rains are received, there might be an opportunity to sow crops for cover. Timing of rainfall and seed availability will influence your crop choice. And then make a plan early and then wait to see what the season brings. So that's all I've got to present there, unless there's some questions coming through.
All right, thanks, Brett. People can fire through any questions they might have. It was coming back from Emma Shattuck regards fibre density is set primarily during mid and late pregnancy. So nutrition is not right during that time. There will impact on fibre density later on. And also, it's well known fact that if we've got poor nutrition now, it's going to impact on condition of the ewes coming into mating next year. So next year, unfortunately, is probably more than likely will be lower lambing percentage as well. So another question was to you, Deb. Can you comment on the risk to livestock of mouldy hay and spoilt grain?
Yeah, so the risk is basically depending on what mycotoxins are in the feed, obviously, but probably the most common things we see during pregnancy is loss of embryos, and then in growing stock you'll see low growth rates, and you can see some signs of just brain sort of issues and things in stock, probably more so in containment if they're not able to access any other feed and that's the only feeds they can access. But yeah, we generally would do a mycotoxin test and then work out which ones were there. But yeah, it depends on body weight of the stock and also what percentage of the ration those mouldy feeds might be.
Yep. Okay. Thank you. A question to Michael. Michael, I guess with these rains, if producers have got weeds germinating on their bare areas, that's got the potential to provide some ground cover. Would you recommend spraying out weeds for next year's crop? So what's the impact of future cropping programs if weeds are left to provide that cover?
Yeah, that's a good one. I think at the moment I would be certainly leaving those weeds grow and providing some crown cover. I think the big thing though is to make sure they don't set seed. So the issue is that let them grow, but once they start to flower and look like they're setting seed, maybe then is a time to actually control them so you're not getting a seed carryover for future years. And you know, it's pretty unlikely that any moisture that they use now is going to carry through anyway into next year. So I don't think you're actually going to be losing very much moisture.
Okay, thanks, Michael. A comment from one of the producers. French millet is in the panic grass family, and this particular producer has had toxicity issues with it. Brett, have you got any comments on that?
That's for prussic acid toxicity, or No, I don't have any comments.
All right.
Don't have any comments on that. So that that's new information to me. So. Thanks for bringing that up.
All right, we can follow that one up and put some information out to people on the webinar.
Yep.
Okay. Another question relating to how does the price of seed compare between millet and sorghum?
The prices there, I tried to get some prices off different marketers. The price at the moment seems to be all over the shop, so it's probably something to go back to your local seed supplier and work out the best price that you can get for both millet and sorghum there. So,
and a question relating to millet. Can you reap millet seed?
From what I understand, there's no problem with reaping millet seed, yeah. So a lot of the grazing one is the Japanese type, which doesn't come under PBR anymore.
All right. A question to Deb, sort of with minimal pasture feed available now and probably going into the future, you've probably done some feed budget and stuff. Roughly how much grain would you need to budget for a, I guess, a ewe over the next six to nine months? Can you throw in a figure of some sort? Just a,
We did quite a lot of budgeting on the West Coast last week at probably roughly 1.75 kilos per head per day dry matter, like a larger ewe would need. You know, probably 20 to 30% of that, or even higher, probably up to 50% can be hay. So you'd have to probably work on 800 to 900 grams of grain, and then good quality hay. But it depends a bit on where your condition score is at the moment. So, you know, if they're in reasonable condition, like condition score 3 now, then you can probably almost go back to just good quality hay to maintain. But we're seeing quite a lot of ewes that are coming out of, you know, post-weaning in lighter condition. So, yeah, you need to look at that 50% or 800 grams of grain just to build them back up for joining. So, you know, that's probably something we're pushing. You know, maintenance is fine for ewes generally, but if you are in condition score 2, you need to get them back up to 3 before joining, or next year's production is going to be down also.
All right, thank you. Any more questions?
No, Ian, I've got one. It's come about in regards to the condition of ewes when they're lambing. Does that affect early weaning as the score level or the general condition of them, Deb?
Yeah, if they're if ewes are coming into lambing in lower condition, which some of them definitely are this year, it's basically just a lighter birth weight generally of the lamb, and we're probably seeing weaners that are quite like a lot like back behind where they should be at sort of 8 to 10 weeks of age. So I think obviously if you're going lower birth weight, lower growth rates, because the ewe doesn't have the nutrition to produce as much colostrum and milk through lactation, then that 15 kilo benchmark for your weaner becomes more important. So it could be that, you know, that weaner's a bit older before it hits that 15 kilos. So, you know, those figures I put up, obviously the weaner's going to need some supplementary feed because at 10 weeks they're still going to have diminished nutrition coming from the milk, but you still need to get them to a reasonable level before you put them through that stress period of weaning.
Thank you.
Right, thanks, Tim.
Just a comment from one of our people on board here is not all foragers are sorghum or sorghum crosses. There are Sudan grass foragers that have a low prussic acid risk. Just a comment.
Yeah, that's right. Yep, those hybrid ones are marketed as lower prussic acid forage crosses. So, and that's right. So certainly don't have as big an issue as those as the straight sorghum.
So. All right. Okay. I think we've sort of hit our 9 o'clock. So I would like to thank the three speakers tonight, Michael, Deb, Brett, and also thank our sponsors, AWI, PIRZA, and the Sheep Industry Fund. So thanks for your attendance, and bye until next time.